So our next speaker is Hugo Erdmann. Yes, please go ahead, yes.
It will be a quicker talk. So it's a session on parametricity. So this parametricity in a very large sense, so not necessarily Reynolds parametricity, or not necessarily unary or binary parametricity, but in a more general sense, where you can say that cubical is univalent parametricity somehow. But we don't care here, it's just very basic parametricity, except that we consider it in not necessary binary or unary. So I'm just rephrasing parametricity as just a way to interpret types, to associate to types, an observational characterization of its inhabitant. So I feel a bit that it's standard after in the session to remind this, but so then it can be unary. So I will write this, but in a new unary case, I gave an example with the notation of Bernardi, Cocon, Moulin. So it characterizes, it's trivial things, but it characterizes the inhabitant of A implies B observationally. And similarly for binary parametricity, where it defines an observational equality. Okay, so again, I think it's a session, so it's nothing more to say. So it can be, parametricity can be iterated. When you iterate it, so if you take the binary case, so you can see the first step of the binary case as depending on a box, one box made of two points, and you are depending on two points. And if you iterate, you are depending on a square with four points and four relations between these points, which are themselves depend on the previous relation. So you immediately get cubes and hypercubes on the cubical and semi-cubical structure. So I think it's standard now to think like that. And so something which has discovered, I don't know how much it's standard, this has been shown by me by Hugo Munkley, is that if you take the unary case, actually, you get semi-simplicial sets. So I don't know how much it's known, but it's very cute. Augmented semi-simplicial sets. So this suggests that one day we, by just changing the arity of the parametricity transition, we will be able to move from cubical to simplicial type theory, maybe one day. So then, second point of the presentation. So you have this iterated parametricity, and so there are the standard semantic interpretation in terms of presheaves, but we can keep the parametricity as it is, as a dependent type, which I will call the index way to present parametricity. So you have two standard ways to present parametricity, so which I will call then the indexed way and the fibered way, which are the standard correspondence used in category theory. So either you represent the relation or the unary predicate as in a dependent way, or you represent it in the fiber way as a type together with a function f, which tells in which is the dependent associated to each object in the global type. So there is a fundamental correspondence, which is implicit, I think, everywhere, but maybe not always put explicitly, but which is that you can prove in type theory that this is a Grothendieck construction somehow in a very simplified way, that this type is equivalent using univalence, axiom to this type. And actually, you can even prove it, I suspect, without univalence if you define to be an equivalence in enough observational way. You inline every time you have function its equality on product, you use pointwise equality and so on. Okay, anyway, and this is the correspondence, the standard one. Okay, so then we can rephrase the difference between semi-cubical sets on parametricity as a difference between the representation. In one case, you represented it again in a fiber way as a presheaves. So iterated fibered, but so it's a bit strange maybe because often presheaves are the index way when you look at Grothendieck deconstruction, construction, but you take the presheaf as a fibered way, and you can see the parametricity, iterated parametricity as the indexed way. Anyway, the point of the talk is to say that there are equations for this, which were presented basically at O2UF, I think 2 years ago, and what we did is just we completed the formalization in Koch of the recipe for writing these types. So it's a combinatorial problem, not more. So which is, then we can, it's the way I formulate it as an iterated index presentation of presheaves of semi-cubical or semi-augmented semi-simplicial sets presented as a presheaf. Oops. And then, so this is the standard way, I think, Mathieu made things similar, Nikolai and Joshua made things similar to define to redefine in an indexed way a semi-cubical presheaf. So as a stream of types, which is a highly dependent type. So we build the types, the type of the base type, the type of the equality on the base types, where nu is the arity here, so it can be one or two, depending on whether you want semi-simplicial or semi-cubical types, and so on. And it's a conductive stream then. So the formalization is there. So it was not easy to do. I don't know in ADDA how easy it's easy to do. In Koch, it was not so easy, especially because of dependencies of inequality proofs. So the construction works. It may look simple in the way it's written, but it's not so simple to define. So you have to define the notion of border. So in this thing, you have to define a signature là-dessus, like this. You have to join, so you need a border restriction map, which goes from border at level n minus 1 to something given a border of level n minus 2. And you have coherence condition to prove between the commutation of the restriction. So all in all, you have to build it's a construction which depends on four levels. So intuitively, it would be a well-founded induction, but it was awful to do a well-founded dependent induction. So at the end, we use what we call a Fibonacci trick, where you carry three levels at a time that you shift one step by one step. Okay, so a lot of dependency in inequality proof. And we use tricks like first, so we have two definitions of inequality, one in strict prop, and in addition to put it in strict prop, we use a Yoneda trick that some people use, so that transitivity is definitional. And we need also induction on the inequality proof, so we commute sometimes with a definitionally proferent inductive formalization of the inequality proof. So it's not meta theory, it's a technical aspect of formalization. And at the end, we realize that we have a very simple algebra of proof of inequality. So sometimes we think, oh, we have inequality proof, we just use a Presburger arithmetic decision solver. But in practice, it seems that we can make much, much direct. So we have a set of combinators and always use these combinators. Then we hope this formalization, which somehow is quite direct, let's say, enfin, it goes to the essential, I think, as a support for building, adding degeneracies, adding bridges or univalent universe, and eventually to get a syntactic translation of cubical type theory in within extensional type theory. And there are questions also then about can we do better in manipulating equation in code? So actually, I'm not sure I'm the best expert, but I would be happy to discuss if people have ideas to how to improve the management of inequality. For instance, how to get more a definitional equality when you do a proof of by induction, like the proof of x plus 0 equal x. You start from a definitional proof, and you propagate definitional proofs. So what at the end could you not say, ah, it's definitional after all? Okay, I'll stop here.
Thank you. So, questions?
So you, let's say, in the most basic case, you have this, let's say, this equivalence between vibrations and tree sheaves. And so what you said, it lifts to the categorical level. Does this happen the same if you go, let's say, higher in your setting? Because you in there, in one case, you have like all these dependent, you have these dependencies which lie over each other.
But I think what I present is not the standard vibration preshift correspondence. It's just I don't start from a vibration like Rotondi vibration. I start from the preshift. And the preshift itself, I see fibers in the definition of the preshifts, and then I go one step more by adding dependent types.
I think one of your beginning slides, you indeed just have this, although it doesn't matter in which direction you start, but you begin here with the, just as you say, a function from, let's say, so from, in this case, from A times A to type. And this, I think even in the slide before, you say that this is equivalent in as some vibration or an intuitive version of vibration, let's say informally. But then, so now I wonder, so this is, let's say, correspondence of then this, let's say, this A star with then the more vibrational view. Could you do like the same story for like A double star? If it is clear what I mean.
I'm not sure I fully understand, but here, it's iterated, so it's an informal claim that it's the same. There is no proof that when you iterate the fiber versus index construction, it works. We believe that it works. Probably we all believe that it works, but it has to be done formally. So I'm saying I'm formalizing this, but there is no proof that there is an equivalence. We can prove it certainly, but there is no proof that these are two equivalent constructions.
Okay, thanks.
Did you use UIP in the formalization?
No, we don't use UHP because I didn't insist on it, but we quantify everything over except. So implicitly, this uses UIP, but only on the fragment we need.
Could you go back to the previous slide you were showing? Yeah, so to my understanding, it was a lot of trouble to define what's on the right there.
Yes.
But wouldn't it arise automatically from these proofs for free translation by Bernardi, Jansson, and Peterson? Because basically, what happens here is you're applying parametricity to the context. So
for any fixed n, it's very easy to do. There are programs by maybe Nicolai, one, or and the one by Bruno, not Bruno, Guillaume Brunnery, who made programs to compute the type of A N star. To be able to have a formula depending on N, so not a fixed N, but generically over N, it's much more complicated because you have to define uniformly the dependencies between the levels, and you have to define this restriction. Where was it? You have to define restriction on the coherence condition between the restriction, which is not absurd at the end, because you have them in the definition of preshift, so they have to be there somewhere. So I didn't give the rule, but they are in the abstract, if you want the more details.
Okay. Let's thank Hugo again.